I've wired up the Colpitts oscillator that we've designed in a previous video because I'd like to take a closer look at the sine wave at the output of the oscillator. I've got our DC power supply set to 9 volts, and at this particular setting, the peak-to-peak voltage of our output sine wave is 3.36 volts. Now, what controls that peak-to-peak voltage, or rather, what controls the amplitude of the sine wave that comes out of our oscillator? Remember, that signal starts from noise and it builds round and round the main loop of the oscillator. But what prevents the signal from continuing to grow? Why does it stop when it gets to 3.36 volts? Well, in the case of the Colpitts oscillator, that amplifier eventually saturates. The transistor eventually saturates. So what I'm asking is really, what controls the saturation point of the transistor? It turns out that it's the power supply voltage. If I change the setting of our DC power supply by moving it up, for instance, then our signal will have more room at the collector of the transistor to swing around. For example, if I increase it from 9 volts up to, say, 12 volts, our peak-to-peak voltage is now grown. It's 4.28 volts. If I turn the voltage at the DC power supply down, say, to 6 volts, then our peak-to-peak voltage of the sine wave has shrunk to 2.2 volts. If I turn it down too far, eventually it's going to stop working altogether, and it turns out that that happens at around 4 volts of a power supply. If I take my hand and I turn the DC power supply up and down at a frequency of about a hertz, then the amplitude of our output sine wave also changes at a frequency of a hertz. What I've done right there is to create a modulator. I've modulated the output of our sine wave at a frequency of 1 hertz. Now, 1 hertz is a very low frequency. And what I would really like to do is modulate our sine wave with an actual signal. In other words, use an audio signal to automatically change the output amplitude of that sine wave, and in doing so I create an AM radio transmitter. What I can say about this sine wave is that it definitely works at 9 volts, it definitely works at 8 volts, and it definitely works at 10 volts. If I were to modulate the voltage of our DC power supply between 8 volts and 10 volts with some signal, then I'm definitely going to get a sine wave out of our Colpitts oscillator where the amplitude varies linearly with the DC power supply input. In order to provide an example audio signal, I'm going to use the Wien-Bridge oscillator that we designed in a previous video. You might recall that our Wien-Bridge oscillator had an audio frequency with an amplitude of 3.36 volts. Now, that 3.36 volts at the output of our Wien-Bridge oscillator was an AC signal. It had 0 volts in the middle, and it swung up to 1.68 volts, and then it swung down to minus 1.68 volts. Let's look at these two circuits side by side because we're going to have to make some adjustments to the voltages. If we put these two circuits side by side with the intention that the Wien-Bridge oscillator will be modulating our Colpitts oscillator, we have 3 minor problems related to the fact that these sine waves aren't the same. The first problem is that the amplitudes are clearly not identical. The second problem is that the center voltage is not the same. And the third problem, perhaps the most serious, is that in this particular configuration, all of the power needed to drive the Colpitts oscillator would have to be provided by the amplifier inside the Wien-Bridge oscillator. It's generally a bad idea to load down the amplifier inside an oscillation loop, because if you load down an amplifier too much, you could cause the loop gain to drop below 1. You could cause, consequently, your oscillator to not work at all. So we generally want to avoid doing that. Let's tackle each of these 3 problems. The first problem, that the amplitudes aren't the same, is very easy to solve. In fact, our Colpitts oscillator will work with the 1.68 volt amplitude of our Wien-Bridge oscillator. The only thing that's really critical here is that the voltage not fall too far below 9 volts. Let's just label these higher and lower because we know it's going to work. It's easy to adjust the amplitude and to solve the third problem that I just mentioned at the same time by inserting an amplifier between the two oscillators. For example, I could use a standard non-inverting configuration amplifier. By adjusting R1 and R2, I can change the amplitude of the signal. And by adding this amplifier between the two oscillators, I can avoid having to load down the amplifier inside the Wien-Bridge oscillator. In other words, I can buffer the output. In this particular example, I think I'd like to increase the amplitude a little bit. Let's give this amplifier a gain of 2. I'm going to make both R1 and R2 equal to 10 kiloohms. And the gain of this amplifier is just 1 plus R1 over R2. That would cause our nominal peak-to-peak voltage to be 6.72 volts at the output of our buffer. We now have a purely AC signal coming out of that buffer that I'd like to mix with a 9-volt DC signal. There are a couple ways we can do this. The first way is to use a standard bias T configuration consisting of a single inductor and a single capacitor. The capacitor, if large enough, allows the AC signal to pass right through it while blocking the DC. The large inductor, on the other hand, allows the 9-volt DC signal to go right through it, but it blocks the AC signal from going up to the ground presented by the DC source. If we were to implement this bias T solution, then our power supply voltage at the Colpitts oscillator would swing around 9 volts, going up to 12.36 volts and down to 5.64 volts. One advantage of using this standard bias T configuration is that if the buffer were to hypothetically not have enough power to drive the Colpitts oscillator, it allows all of the power to come from the DC source. In our particular circuit here, though, I'm not going to use the bias T because I know that the buffer has enough power to run our Colpitts oscillator. If we look for a moment at just the Colpitts oscillator, I see that there are 5 grounding pins. Each of these is at 0 volts, and the center voltage at the power supply needs to be 9 volts. In other words, we have 9 volts across our Colpitts oscillator. If I subtract 9 volts from the ground and I subtract 9 volts from the power supply voltage, then the circuit will still work. For example, everywhere I have a grounding symbol, I could just connect our Colpitts oscillator to the minus 9 volts of our power supply. I could then run a pure AC signal into the power supply of our Colpitts oscillator and it would still work because it still has a large voltage across it. I can then hook our buffer directly to the power rail of our Colpitts oscillator. I have here the Wien-Bridge oscillator that we put together in a previous video. I'm going to go ahead and make all of these connections that we've just outlined in the circuit diagram, and then we'll take a look at the output. So here I have our Wien-Bridge oscillator that we put together in a previous video. I have connected the output pin at our Wien-Bridge oscillator over here through some wires to an audio buffer with a gain of 2. The output of the buffer then runs into the power line of our Colpitts oscillator. I'm going to go ahead and turn it on so that we can take a look at our amplitudes. I'd first like to look at the output of our Wien-Bridge oscillator to verify that it's similar to what we saw in a previous video. It looks like our peak-to-peak voltage here is about 3.44 volts, so it's very similar to what we expected. Let's take a look at the same signal after the audio buffer that has a gain of 2. All right, so it looks like our peak-to-peak voltage is now approximately 6.84 volts. Let's now look at the output of our Colpitts oscillator. And we kind of see a mess on the screen, and that's what we expect because we have a very high frequency signal being modulated by a very low frequency signal. If I hit auto set, the oscilloscope will do its best to clean it up. I think the oscilloscope has done a pretty good job here. Sometimes we see a sine wave with a lower peak-to-peak voltage, and sometimes we see a sine wave with a higher peak-to-peak voltage. Basically, we've just created an AM radio transmitter. So if I grab our radio and I tune it to the frequency of our Colpitts oscillator, we should be able to hear our radio transmission. So I've got this radio tuned to 1100 kilohertz. If I turn off the power supply, the signal should be gone. All right, so this somehow shows that our signal is really being generated here and showing up at our radio. I'm going to go ahead and turn it off. We've just successfully made an AM radio transmitter, and we've transmitted a tone at a single frequency, the output of our Wien-Bridge oscillator. But there's no reason why we can't transmit anything else. We have an audio cable right here that was used to connect the Wien-Bridge oscillator to the Colpitts oscillator. I could plug this audio cable into a mobile phone or any audio port, and we could then create a proper audio transmitter. In a future video, we'll transmit some music with our AM radio transmitter. But before we do that, I'd like to step back and look at some of the mathematics of AM radio transmission.